All of us are very uncomfortable with death. Maybe not so much for teenagers or people in their 20s, but as we begin to round middle age, the prospect of dying becomes worrisome. And as a result of this, many people tried to hide and hope that it will go away. William Randolph Hearst used to forbid people to mention death in his presence. Some people avoid going to doctors because they're afraid they may hear bad news. We live in tremendous denial. I think Ernst Becker actually wrote a book called The Denial of Death. Morticians camouflage the dead. People sometimes at a funeral say, "Doesn't Fred look great?" He didn't look so great a few weeks ago, but at his funeral, Fred could look wonderful, because we don't want people to even appear to look dead. Some people try to outrun death by building monuments to themselves, by carving their name into a tree or building a pyramid. But they want something to last beyond their own life. People don't want to feel that life is going to come to an end. Woody Allen once quipped that, "I don't want to achieve immortality through my work. I want to achieve it through not dying." Now, I would suggest that one of the greatest misconceptions about Judaism centers around the issue of death and what comes afterward. I don't think there is probably any other area in Jewish thought that is so misunderstood. Dennis Prager, I think Dennis spoke here last night or the night before, so Dennis Prager once described a funeral he attended, and he said at the funeral, the rabbi declared that Judaism does not believe in an afterlife. And the rabbi insisted that the dead only live on in the memory of their friends and family who they leave behind. The rabbi really should have said that he doesn't believe in an afterlife, rather than declaring this in the name of Judaism. It's also very common to hear people say that Judaism does not believe in heaven or hell. I once had a social studies teacher in high school who used to tell us that in matters of religion and politics, people often speak with a degree of certainty inversely proportional to how much they actually know. Now, I think some of the misconceptions about the topic we'll be dealing with tonight might stem from an anti-supernatural bias that crept into modern Judaism from the Enlightenment. I think up until the time of the Enlightenment, people didn't have difficulty with things that were miraculous, things that were not easily measured with our senses. And I think that as a result of the Enlightenment, speaking about the world of the spirit just became uncomfortable for many modern Jews. Secondly, another factor might be that many Jewish people have a tremendous allergy to anything that might even remotely sound like it has anything to do with Christianity. So if Christians speak about X, Y, or Z, then we have nothing to do with something like that. Tonight, what I'm going to try to do is present an outline. I stress, I'm going to try to present an outline of traditional Jewish teaching on the topic of the afterlife. I should state at the outset that no one really knows exactly what will happen after death, and very few people are very anxious to try to find out. Therefore, much of what I'll be sharing tonight is somewhat speculative and provisional. In addition, I should stress there isn't only one traditional Jewish view on this topic of the afterlife. There tend to be several strains of opinion, And what I'll be trying to do is share with you some of those strains. However, the basics of what I'll be sharing tonight are alluded to in the scriptures, in our Holy Bible, and in rabbinic literature. So I'll try to summarize, I hope, what is more or less the prevalent understanding. Now, one of the major problems, I think this is probably the big one, with understanding the topic of the afterlife, was captured by the venerable Chinese philosopher Confucius, who lived about 2,500 years ago, when he said, "We don't know anything about life. So what can we know about death?" And so I'm going to have to share with you a bit of a long preamble tonight in order to understand the Jewish view of death and the afterlife, because it really all hinges on our view of life in the first place. And I think the first question we have to understand, the real question, it's a bit of a conundrum at the outset tonight, is not why people die, but why are we alive in the first place? Meaning, why are we here in this world in the first place? As we'll see, God had a very different option available to him for creating human beings than the kind of world that we know. We're all familiar with this world, but the truth is, if we understand God's agenda in creating a world, he could have created a much different kind of world. And it's important that we understand why are we in this world rather than another kind of existence. What was God's intention in creating human beings? So the Bible says, after each day of creation, Vayar Elohim ki tov, normally translated, and God saw that it was good. But the German Bible commentary of Yaakov Tzvi Mecklenburg in his Ketav HaKabbalah writes that Vayar Elohim ki tov can be translated really as the causative. Vayar, and he caused it to be seen. God caused it to be seen, ki tov, because he is good. Meaning, after each thing that's created, the Bible's not telling you that God made it and then God looked at it and said, "Hey, pretty good." I mean, that's absurd. God's not going to make something and look at it and say, I give myself an 85. So it's not giving you an evaluation of the quality of what God made. It's telling you, after each thing that was created, why did God make it? Vayar Elohim ki tov, God brought it into existence because he is good. Meaning that the motivation for creation is God's love and altruism. Creation was not for his sake. Our sages teach that the nature of someone who is good is to do good, to give. And God created us out of his desire to give, to have a recipient for his goodness. Just like parents want their children to have a life of ultimate fulfillment and pleasure, God wants no less for us. The famous Jewish Kabbalist Rav Moshe Chaim Luzzatto, a brilliant Italian mystic from the 18th century, expressed it like this in his famous book, Derech Hashem, The Way of God. He writes, "God's purpose in creation was to bestow his good to another. Since God desired to bestow good, a partial good would not be sufficient. If God's going to do something, he's doing it all the way. The good that he bestows would have to be the ultimate good that his handiwork could accept. God is not interested in creating human beings who will go through life in second or third class. God's desire is that we experience life in first class." Now, what is this pleasure? What is this great pleasure that God seeks to give us? It's obviously not a piece of cheesecake, or 15 minutes of fame, or even winning the Mega Millions. It should happen to all of us. As Tevye said, "May the Lord strike me with it, may I never recover." But Rabbi Luzzatto goes on to explain that the ultimate pleasure is eternal pleasure. Cheesecake is not eternal. The ultimate pleasure is an eternal pleasure. And that opportunity to attach ourselves to the greatest good in the world and the source of all other pleasures. That's the greatest pleasure possible, to attach ourselves to the source of all other pleasures, the headquarters of everything in this world. So he writes, God alone is the only true good, and therefore, his beneficent desire would not be satisfied unless he could bestow that very good. What does God want to give us? Himself. The nature of this true benefit is his giving created beings the opportunity to attach themselves to him to the greatest degree possible for them. Bonding with God and knowing him is clearly a spiritual experience. It's not a physical experience. Our bodies would be irrelevant, and they might even get in the way and interfere. So I go back to my question. If God's intention is for us to experience closeness with him, why create us in a physical body and put us in a physical world? Why not just create us as simply a spiritual, non-physical soul and allow us to exist in a blissful heavenly realm forever? That's my question. If the ultimate goal is for us to experience the greatest pleasure, which is God, so what experience is God? It's not our stomach, it's not our fingers, it's our soul. And so if that's the agenda, so I'm asking, why are we alive in this world in a body? God should have just stuck us in heaven as a soul. That seems to have been, would have been a much more direct and efficient way of achieving his agenda. Why put us in this physical world, in a physical body, where it's so easy to get distracted from the spiritual and even tarnish our pure spiritual souls by sinning? It's tremendously dangerous in this world. Rabbi Luzzatto explains that if the goal is for us to have pleasure, and hear me well, if the goal is for us to have pleasure, we all know that we have infinitely more pleasure from something that we earn and deserve by working for it than something that we get as a handout, as welfare, as charity. As a matter of fact, we don't feel good when we get something that we didn't work for or earn or deserve. We're actually embarrassed by it. And the Kabbalists refer to this as the Nahama de Chisufa, the bread of shame. When you get something that you didn't deserve, you didn't work for, you don't get pleasure out of it. You're embarrassed by it. So for God to place us in paradise without having to work for it would not really accomplish what he set out to accomplish. If God wants us to have ultimate pleasure, that will only happen in an environment where we're able to earn it by working for it rather than just getting it as a free gift. Therefore, God did not create us simply as a spiritual entity, a spiritual soul. The Torah tells us that we were created from the dust of the earth, that God then breathed this breath of life into. We are both physical and spiritual, what Rabbi Eliezer Berkowitz referred to as biopsychic beings. Not only did God fuse our soul into his physical body. He put us into a physical world where there are numerous challenges, temptations, and distractions to draw us away from a relationship with him. In addition, think about this. We live in a world where God is not visible. We cannot see God. The Hebrew word for world is olam. Olam means hidden, concealed, because the Creator is concealed in the world he created. The world seems to be able to function perfectly well without him. There were actually philosophers called the deists who believed that God created the world and then took a vacation in Mexico. And he's not involved with running the world. He just set it up and it runs all by itself. And so if we're not feeling well, we can go to the doctor, take some medicine, and we feel great. And we don't have to believe that God had anything to do with it. I got a great doctor, wonderful pharmacist, great drugs, thank God. We can go to work and make money and feed our families. We can have a land as a people and defend it. And we could assume, as the Bible says, Kochi ve'otzem yodi osu li eskol achayel hazeh. It's my strength and my might that have given me all of this. We're put into a world where it's not clear that our prayers, our Torah study, our acts of kindness, our performance of mitzvot, the perfection of our character, really have much impact on our lives at all. We're supposed to get close to God, but obviously a relationship that's forced is not really a relationship. So how do we form a relationship with God? And how do we attach ourselves to God? We live in a world where there's tremendous tension between our body and our soul. We feel both of them. We feel drawn to our soul, we feel drawn to our body. We often feel in conflict. My soul pulls me in one direction. I know I should get up this morning and pray. My body says, stay in bed. You don't need to get up to pray. This is a constant tension that we feel between our body and our soul. And this tension between our body and our soul, between the physical and the spiritual, is the arena in which free will operates. That's the arena in which we as human beings get to choose. We get to choose spirituality. We get to choose godliness. We get to choose to put God in our lives rather than living without God. But it's a choice. And we have tremendous obstacles to overcome in making this choice. It's not easy. Tremendous obstacles to live a virtuous life. But by making these choices, we become deserving of our closeness with God. The Talmud teaches that we can get close to God by emulating him, by modeling our lives after God, by being like him. The first thing we learn about God in the Bible is that he is a creator. And he didn't have to create the world. He did the creation as an act of free will, as an act of love. But God's first action in the Bible is to create. And by placing us in bodies and in a physical world, he provides for us an arena of free will for us to be like him. How? Because we can be creators just like God. That's what we can become. Human beings can become creators. It's interesting, by the way, that when the Bible speaks about the creation of man, it says we were made B'Tselem Elohim, in the image of God. The Bible has many different names for God. It has the Tetragrammaton, the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, Shaddai, Tzva'ot. There are many names of God in the Bible. Why does the Bible specifically say that we were made in the image of Elohim? And the famous student of the Vilna Gaon, Rav Chaim of Elozhin, says that we're told that we're made in the image of Elohim because Elohim is the name that's used for the creation of the world. The whole creation story is what Elohim did. That's the name of God that's used. And we're told that we're in the image of God in that we can be like God in that we also can create. How do we create? We create ourselves. That's what we get to create. Each one of us is here in this world to create a masterpiece. Everything else in the world, God created unilaterally. God said, let there be light. Let there be dogs. Let there be trees. Let there be stars. God makes everything unilaterally. When it comes to the human being, God says, let us make man. And according to the Baal Shem Tov, God is speaking to each and every one of us. And God is saying to each human being, come on, Bubala, we're going to create you. I'm going to give you the raw ingredients. God says to each of us, I will give you a body and a soul. But who you ultimately become is a function of what you do with those ingredients. What do you do with your body and your soul? What choices do you make? And in making those choices, every single time, you choose the eternal over the temporal. Every time you choose the righteous over what's convenient. Every time you choose spirituality over the material, you're growing. You're creating yourself. You're becoming a greater and bigger human being. So to sum up thus far, the reason that we are alive in a physical body is to allow for the kind of tension that provides an arena for free will. This allows us to work and earn our closeness to God by choosing it rather than just receiving it passively. Now let's go to the next step. Originally, human beings were supposed to be immortal. That was the original plan. Out of the starting gate, human beings were supposed to live forever. It was only after eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil that Adam and Eve became mortal, as well as all of their descendants. Human beings became mortal. God doesn't say, by the way, if you eat from that tree, you're going to drop dead. God says, on the day you eat from it, mot tamut, dying you will die, meaning you'll become mortal. Because they didn't drop dead as soon as they ate from the fruit, but they became mortal. Why is that? Why is that? We know in the Bible, knowledge, the word to know, expresses intimacy. And Adam knew his wife Eve. This is the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That somehow, after eating from this tree, human beings became intimate with something. And that was themselves. We became intimate with our own bodies. We became very, very attached to our bodies. Prior to eating from this tree, humans had an objective view of who they were. They understood the true nature of their bodies and their souls. It was understood that their souls were clothed with a physical body. But the physical was understood to be in service of the spiritual and separate from the spiritual. After eating from this tree, it no longer was so separate. They became mixed up. Their bodies began to take on a life of their own. They began to subjectively identify with their bodies. Their bodies became more and more a way of how they saw themselves. Eating became an act of physical pleasure in its own right and not necessarily connected to the soul. That was the difference. Prior to eating from this tree, everything was connected to the soul. They understood there is soul, and everything I'm doing is to to serve this soul, to help this soul. So the act of eating was not an act of eating that was mindless, that was consciousnessless. Eating was a spiritual activity. It was the food was taken as a way of building the soul. After they ate from this tree, the physical assumed its own arena, and eating became a pleasure in its own right. Previous to this, the physical world and its temptations were external to us. They were external to us. The snake, which represents our evil inclination, was an external force in the world. But after eating from this tree of knowledge of good and evil, we became intimate with it. It became an internal thing. We couldn't separate our desires from reality. And this is what caused Adam and Eve to become ashamed and to try and hide from God. Because of this confusion, it became impossible for human beings to ultimately and truly fulfill the purpose of their creation. Embracing and identifying with the physical made it much more difficult for our souls to soar and embrace a true connection with God. Being immortal at this stage would totally entrap us and enmesh us in the materialistic world, and we would lose connection with the spiritual. Death became a necessity. It's actually a great act of kindness for God to bring death into our lives. Death became a necessity at this stage to break the intimate connection between the body and the soul by allowing the soul to cleave to God unencumbered by the body. That's what happens after we die. The sage of the Talmud, the Talmudic sages tell us that this is a great blessing. After each day of creation, as we saw, the Bible says, and God saw that it was good. But after the entire creation process, it says, and God saw everything he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the rabbis ask, what is very good? They say, very good, that's death. Death is very good for us. Because in death, the soul learns that it's not a body. The question is, what happens after we die? What happens after death? So when we ask the question, what happens after we die, we have to remember, who is this we? The we is composed of two parts, our body and our soul. We first became alive. We first became alive when God took lifeless dust and breathe the breath of life into it. What is death? Death is simply the removal of our soul from our body. That's all death is. Death is a departure of our soul from our body. Life was the implanting of the soul into our body. Death is the removal of the soul from the body. Our souls, of course, being spiritual, continue to exist after our bodies return to the earth. King Solomon wrote in the book of Kohelet, in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 17, the dust will return to the ground as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. Now, it's very hard, and I appreciate this, for people to imagine what this means. What does it mean that our soul continues to exist? What is that like? And I think many people have a hard time believing in the afterlife precisely because they can't imagine what existence is without a body. It's a famous book, Gesher HaChaim, which speaks about death and mourning. And he tells a famous parable of two twins in a uterus, two twins that are about to be born. And they have this ongoing argument, because in the uterus, these two twins are living it up. Everything is provided for them. It's nice. It's comfortable. There's air conditioning. It's the proper temperature. They got enough food. Everything is beautiful. But then they begin to wonder, so what's next? What happens if we have to leave this place? So one of the twins happens to be a very optimistic and says, I am sure that after we leave this place, we're going to go to an even better place. And the other one says, you're a fruitcake. What are you talking about? After this, you evaporate, you disintegrate, you come to an end, you're finished. There is nothing after this. And back and forth, they argue that back and forth, obviously, who's going to know? Until that day, 9 months after they're conceived, the optimist is the first one to emerge. The attending doctor picks up the baby, slaps it in the tuchus. He begins to take his first breath, begins to scream and cry, and his brother in the uterus says, I was right! I knew it! If you leave this place, you're going to perish a horrible death. It is bad news ever to leave this place. And he doesn't know that in that room, there's a big celebration going on, Mazel Tov, people are making l'chaims, because this little baby has now emerged into the next stage of life. I think there are some very compelling reasons for us to understand that the possibility of continued existence after death is very, very reasonable. The Lubavitcher Rebbe used to always say that the first law of thermodynamics in physics teaches that energy is never destroyed or lost. Energy merely assumes another kind of form. And he said, if this is true regarding physical energy, then how much more so when it comes to spiritual energy, spiritual reality of the soul whose existence is not limited to time or space. It too will pass from one form of existence into another. Also, does it make any sense for God to create human beings and allow his creatures to spend their lives in an effort to achieve perfection, only to have everything come to a terrible end just 70, 80, 100 years later? What would be the point? Also, there's so much injustice in this world. God's fairness would seem to require and demand a realm where accounts could be settled, where the righteous who suffer during their time on this earth can truly be rewarded, and the wicked who seem to skate by and enjoy a wonderful, pleasurable life in this world can get their payback. Now, in recent times, many of you are aware of the fact that there's been a tremendous amount of research into near-death experiences. These are people who were pronounced clinically dead. Their brains didn't register any activity. Their hearts stopped beating. Their senses ceased to register any stimuli. Yet these people who were pronounced clinically dead could later recount exactly what happened in the rooms where their bodies laid after they were pronounced dead. They could tell who came in and out of the room. They could recount exactly what was said and conversed about in front of them and as they laid there dead. In the 20th century, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross and Raymond Moody did studies of countless people, not just in North America, countless people throughout the entire world, all reporting very similar experiences of what happened after they were pronounced dead. There's a pediatrician from Seattle, Dr. Melvin Morse, who studied children who had survived cardiac arrest. And he concluded that their near-death experiences were not due to the taking of drugs or cultural conditioning. In one of his studies, there was a child who was pronounced dead that reported afterward that they had traveled out of their body and went home from the hospital, and described exactly what their family members were wearing, what exactly they were doing, what video games his brother was playing on the computer. And all of these observations were later confirmed to be accurate. As well, countless people who never died, people in this room, I'm sure, report having had very clear and dramatic encounters with their loved ones who had died. They either came to them in dreams or appeared to them in apparitions. Some of these incredible stories can be found in a recent book published by Yitta Halberstam and Judith Leventhal called Small Miracles from Beyond, published in 2014. If I had time, I would share some of these stories with you. They would absolutely blow your minds. That's an ad to buy the book. When people die, the quality of that experience is very different for different people. Upon the separation of the soul from the body is buried, and the soul enters into a state of existence called the Olam HaNeshamot, the world of souls. The Talmud teaches us that for righteous people who spent their lives trying to grow spiritually, for these people, the separation of their souls from their bodies will be just like removing a strand of hair from a saucer of milk. That's how easy and smooth the separation of the body from the soul will be. Because they never got too attached to their bodies. For them, death is not terrifying, and it's not traumatizing to their soul. However, for people who spent their entire lives pursuing only physical pleasures and material comfort and ignoring their spiritual lives, for them, death will be very, very difficult. The Talmud says that for them, the separation of the body from the soul will be like trying to pull a tuft of wool out of a thicket of thorns. It's not going to come out so easily, because the soul there is very attached to the body. These are people that have come to totally identify with their bodies. They were basically living only as a body and engaged only in physical activities. For these people, their souls will feel very disoriented upon death. Their souls have been so wrapped up in their bodies, they will have a hard time even relating to what a spiritual existence is. For them, it will be very difficult to disconnect from the physical world and to appreciate the spiritual pleasures possible in an afterlife. These people will have to go through a rehabilitative process to allow their souls to come into their own. Part of this will be the shock of being buried and undergoing physical decomposition. You can imagine, to a soul that was so intimately wrapped up in a body, the sages call it chibut hakever, to hear the grave, the coffin slamming shut. That final announcement must be terrifying. To experience their own body decomposing, this body they had been so connected to, starts to decay, that must be terrifying to a soul that only identified as being a body. For spiritually refined people, it will feel just like taking off one garment and putting on another. But for people whose souls atrophied, it will be a very uncomfortable experience to go through the death process. Of course, Judaism emphasizes that much of this discomfort can be avoided if we wake up before we die and begin focusing on our lives properly. It's one of the major teachings of Judaism. In the Talmud, Rabbi Eliezer would say, "Repent one day before you die." And his students would say, "But Rebbe, you don't know when you're going to die." And he would say, "Good point, grasshopper. Therefore, do it now." So people who begin to wake up, and by the way, our sages teach us that that's the purpose of illness. You know that illness didn't exist in the world until Jacob died. Until Jacob, our patriarch, died, people would not get sick. They would sneeze and they would drop dead. And that's why we say God bless you when someone sneezes. But by Jacob, we're told before he died, he got sick. He was the first person ever to get sick. And the reason is, our sages teach us, it's giving us a little bit of a wake-up call. You know, the Chafetz Chaim said that when you get your first gray hair, it's a summons to the Supreme Court upstairs. So God has many ways of calling out to us and saying, look, you went through so much of your life already, ignoring your soul. Isn't it time to wake up? Start devoting some time to spiritual things in life, to growing spiritually, to working on yourself, to growing as a person, to studying Torah, to doing mitzvot, to helping other people, to working on your character traits, to doing chesed. There's so many things that we're supposed to be involved in, and people seem to just ignore it and play video games. It's so easy to waste our time in this world and to get distracted. People who lived righteous lives and rectified their souls while they were alive will exist in this Olam HaNeshamot, this world of souls, where they'll experience reward for their virtues and exist in an extremely pleasurable state of existence. They'll take great pleasure in all the good they did, all the wisdom they achieved, and all of their spiritual accomplishments. This experience is referred to as Gan Eden, the Garden of Eden. By the way, the people in the world of souls are aware of the major challenges facing their loved ones back here in this physical world. And they're able to assist us by praying for us or by actually offering us advice by coming to us in dreams and in other ways of communicating with us. But what happens to people who did not rectify themselves enough spiritually yet? These people will need further purification of their souls, and they'll enter into a state of existence known as Gehenna. This is not to be confused with the Christian idea of hell from Dante's Inferno, where there's eternal suffering and gnashing of teeth and burning in fire. That's not the Jewish concept of Gehenna. First of all, Gehenna is not so much an experience of punishment as it is one of rehabilitation. It's also not eternal. The experience of Gehenna can last for moments. You could be there for a second. Or it can last up to 1 year maximum. That's it. Meaning even the most spiritually challenged people can usually get their souls dry cleaned in a year. What is the basic experience of Gehenna? What happens in this state of Gehenna? I don't know. But our sages teach us that the basic idea is that we are able to very clearly see and understand all the failures of our life. We're able to clearly understand the negative impact of all the wrong things that we did, both to ourselves and to others. When we do something wrong, we don't only hurt other people, we hurt ourselves. And we don't often appreciate the incredible impact that our deeds can have. We don't realize that if we insult someone, it can ruin their day, and they might kick their dog. And there might be a whole chain of events just from the one negative thing if you gave someone a cross look, or you didn't say good morning to someone. In Gehenna, we're going to see the incredible clear impact of everything that we did that was a failure. And that's going to cause tremendous shame and embarrassment. When we see and re-experience all the passion that we had in pursuing nonsense or pursuing things that were actually destructive, it'll cause tremendous shame and embarrassment. And what this shame and embarrassment will do will be to clear away the barriers that were created between us and God when we did the wrong thing. And this will then allow our souls to experience the spiritual pleasures of the afterlife. Now, Jewish mystics teach there's another possibility that may occur to help us rectify parts of our soul that didn't complete their mission while we were alive. This is something called Gilgul Nishamot. Some people call this reincarnation. Our mystics teach that our soul is not a simple entity. Our souls actually are composite entities. Our literature speaks basically of five different levels to the soul. There's the nefesh, the part of our soul that's basically the animating life force of who we are. Animals, by the way, have a nefesh. The nefesh is what keeps us alive. Then there's a level of ruach. That's the emotional part of who we are. Our feelings, our emotions. Then there's the third level, the neshama, which is the intellect and the spiritual part where we connect spiritually to the beyond. And then there are two parts to our soul which are not even part of our attached to our body. It's the parts of our soul that really connect us to God, which I can't explain. It's the chaya and the yechida. So we have different parts to our soul, and by the way, each of these five parts has all the other five parts within it. Now normally, the three upper levels, in the Shema, the Chaya, and Yechida, are very, very difficult to corrupt, almost impossible to corrupt. But some people may have other parts of their souls needing rectification, and so what the Kabbalists teach is that those parts of our soul may enter into another human body in order to allow those parts to be rectified. You should know that reincarnation is not universally accepted by all Jews, although it seems to be accepted by the vast majority of Jewish teachers. I should also point out that for a very small number of people, who were thoroughly evil in their lives and not able to be rehabilitated through Gehenna or any other means, they will exist forever in shame and humiliation in Gehenna. They will not be able to experience the afterlife. They will basically have eternal misery. But that's a very, very, very small fragment of people. Humanity itself will enter its next phase of existence in the Messianic Age. This will be a time in human history where human strife will be eliminated, wars will cease, and people will be able to pursue spirituality and a relationship with God relatively unencumbered. In the Messianic Age, it'll be possible for people to devote themselves to spiritual pursuits. At some point during this Messianic Age, the next stage will take place, which is called Techiyat HaMeitim, the resurrection of the dead. Our bodies will be reconstituted like plants that emerge from seeds that first decompose in the ground and then sprout. But our bodies will become more refined bodies than we are now. They'll be less coarse, less tethered to the physical, more ethereal bodies. We won't need to eat physical food, for example. We'll be able to survive and receive our nourishment from spiritual means only. But we will have bodies that come back to life. And now there are two major views on what happens next. The minority view is the one taken by the Rambam Maimonides. Maimonides holds that the purpose of this period, why are our bodies going to come back? What is the purpose of that? Maimonides says that while people lived in this world, most of humanity lived in a world that was a very broken world, a world of strife, a world of war, especially for Jews, a world where we're always being persecuted. Maimonides says that for most people who lived throughout human history, life was difficult, and it was hard to pursue the spiritual. So they're given a chance to come back into the Messianic Age, to live a life again in a more refined world where it will be easier for them to devote themselves to spirituality. However, Maimonides says that after these people live in a resurrected body, they will die again. And then their souls alone, just the spiritual part of who they are, will enter into the existence of what is called Olam Haba, the world to come, which is basically a blissful, eternal paradise. Maimonides says that people that finish their resurrection stage will exist eternally as a soul in the state of bliss, experiencing the knowledge and reality of God. That's all, folks. But most other Jewish sages take a different approach here. They say that the time of the resurrection is not only to allow people to experience life in the ideal messianic age, but that ultimately we will live forever as a composite, complete human being, a body and a soul. Why is this? Why do we have to exist in the future, not just as a soul, but as a soul reunited with the body? So the Talmud tells the following story. I'm going to read it to you. Antoninus Marcus Aurelius said to Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi in the second century, "The body and the soul can both escape God's judgment." This Roman wise person said, you know what? In the future, the body and the soul, they can get away with murder. Why? The body and the soul can escape God's judgment because the body can defend itself by saying, it was the soul who sinned. Because look, since the day the soul left me, I have lain still like an idle stone in the grave and have not committed any sins. If it wasn't for the soul, I wouldn't do anything wrong. That's what the body could say. And the soul can likewise say, it was the body that sinned. Since I left the body, I have flown free like a bird. Rabbi Yehuda replied, I'll offer you a parable in response. A human king once possessed a beautiful garden full of young, delicious figs. He assigned two guards to watch the garden. One of them was crippled and one of them was blind. The crippled guard said to the blind one, I see luscious fruit in this garden. Carry me on your shoulders and we'll share them. And that's exactly what they did. The blind man carrying the lame one until they had consumed the choicest fruit of the garden. When the king returned, he accosted his watchmen, asking, where are my delicious, luscious fruit? The blind man answered, do I have eyes that I could locate the fruit? The crippled guard said, do I have feet that I could retrieve the fruit? But the wise king was not fooled. What did he do? He placed the crippled man on the blind man's shoulders and judged them as one. So too, God summons the soul and restores it to the body, and then judges the two together. So we see at the end of time, we're taught that a human being will be judged and rewarded as a whole person with a body and a soul. Let me wrap up. Our sages teach us that we can actually experience a taste of Olam Haba, a taste of this eternal, blissful paradise in this world. We have the opportunity of experiencing a foretaste of what Olam Haba will be like. One of those ways of experiencing Olam Haba is Shabbat. Shabbat is called Me'ein Olam Haba, a foretaste, a little taste of the world to come. Because Shabbat is an opportunity for us to spend 25 hours immersed in the spiritual. Our meals are not physical meals. Our meals are spiritual meals. Shabbat is a time we don't have to work. We can spend our time praying with leisure, studying the Torah, deepening our relationship with other people. But the sages tell us that only the one that prepares for the Shabbat is able to eat on the Shabbat. You cannot cook on the Sabbath. If you want to eat on the Sabbath, you have had to prepare it from before the Sabbath. So we learn here a very vital lesson. Our experience of Olam Haba ultimately in the future requires preparation. The purpose of this world that we're living in, our sages say, this world is a prose door. This world is an antechamber to the world to come. We are in this world, as I said before, to work. The verse in the book of Iyov, of the book of Job, which says, Adam la'amol yilud. A person was born in order to work. That's why we're here in this world. We're here to work. We're here to work on ourselves. We're here to work on perfecting ourselves. We're here to growing spiritually. We're here to preparing ourselves so that in the future, when we enter into the world to come, it's not going to be a huge transition. One of the parables that's given for the world to come is that God's going to be teaching a class in Talmud to everyone. For people from whom learning God's wisdom was important in their lives, this will be the most amazing thing in the world. For people who totally ignored that, it'll be like going to hell. I've got to sit in a Talmud class for the rest of my existence. So everything that we do in this world now, while we're alive, is in preparation for the world to come. Both this world and the next world can be incredibly pleasurable. The rabbis teach us in Ethics of the Fathers, in Pirkei Avot, that all of the pleasures of this world don't equal one sniff of the pleasures of the world to come. Which means it's not just that all the pleasures of this world, and Rav Dessler explains that it means all the pleasures of this world, it means take all the pleasures you ever had in your whole life, and then take all the pleasures of every person alive in the world today, all 7 billion people, take all their pleasure, and add that to the pleasure of every person who ever lived. The Talmud is saying that all of that pleasure, all the pleasure of this world, doesn't equal not tasting a knish in the world to come. It means it doesn't even equal walking into the store and smelling the knish. That's how incredible the world to come will be. We can't even imagine how much pleasure there is there. But the Talmud says, incredibly, that all the pleasure in the world to come does not equal 1 hour spent in this world in growing spiritually. So at the end of the day, we live a life where there's incredible potential for pleasure, both in this world and the world to come. I pray that all of us will be able to experience both of these potentials for pleasure, hopefully in a very long life in this world, and then a very long life in the world to come.